I'm just curious. Those of you sitting out there at the tables right now having lunch, raise your hand if you've never been on Facebook. Never been on Facebook. 5, 6, 7, 8. Okay.
They're lying.
That's kind of what we're here to talk about. Social media, how it affects not you personally, not just you personally, but you professionally as well. I've got Dr. John Kaminsky from Penn State University, Barry Chandler next to me. He is the bar blogger. Kim Kellogg next to him from Grasshopper Property Maintenance, and Mark Jordan from the Westfield Group as well. I'm going to start with you, Barry. Introduce yourself. Tell us exactly what it is you do.
Okay, thank you. Barry Chandler is my name. I run a business called Interactive Hospitality, and I run a blog called The Bar Blogger. Obviously, I'm not from this neck of the woods, as you can tell from the accent. I'm an Irishman in Columbus as opposed to an Englishman in New York. But I work with bars and restaurants, hospitality businesses, to create social media campaigns that utilize Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn, YouTube, to reduce the cost of acquiring a customer. So to reduce the cost of print advertising, TV, radio, and to build a community of fans of a business online through the free, relatively free tools that we have available to us, like Facebook and Twitter.
Okay, moving on down, pass it on down there to Kim. Kim Kellogg, introduce yourself.
We have a full-service lawn and landscape company in Amish country in Holmes County. So we find social media really a good way to communicate with our Amish customers. That was a joke. Not a very funny one, but, you know, it was a joke. We are infants, and Barry did a presentation this morning that was absolutely outstanding, and we are realizing how much we have and how powerful the whole social media thing can be for us in lawn care, landscaping. Right now, we use it primarily to communicate with customers and inform people, and we've got some stuff to show you a little bit later.
John? You're from Penn State, so you deal with the students a lot more than anybody else does, and they're the ones that are really locked into this.
Yeah, I think the students are locked in some aspects. I think Facebook is clearly the biggest one for them. Twitter is kind of a black box for them as well. They don't like it all that much. Some of them do. I guess one of my focuses is to try to make sure that they learn to use it properly in the privacy settings. So when it deals with the students, that's what I'm looking at. When it deals with the industry and the outreach efforts, we look at trying to provide information for a larger group of people without doing as much effort. So you can't talk to everybody individually, but if you can send messages out that reach a large audience, then you're more effective.
And Mark, introduce yourself and tell us something about yourself.
I'm Mark Jordan. I'm Natural Resource Leader at Westfield Group Country Club. We're up in the Akron, Cleveland area. And we're a private-owned country club, and we have about 600 members. And for us, the importance of member communication, and with the diverse group of members that we have, some people don't even have a computer, the older demographics, they still like to communicate via hard copies. But also we have the young up-and-comers who really get into the tweeting and the Facebooks and so forth. So blending that wide array of communication together is a constant challenge for us.
Okay, let's get to some questions that we have on here to get to know a little bit more about what we're talking about. Anybody can chime in. Two of you have microphones. If you got something to say, just grab one of those. If somebody's interested in starting a social media account business-wise, what's first and foremost important there?
I think the first thing you have to do is understand what it is you want to achieve. Are you using social media just because you hear everybody is using it, or is there something specific you want to do with it? You need to establish a goal primarily. And once you understand what you want to achieve, I recommend looking at who your customer is, understanding who your customer is first of all. If all of your customers are 80 years old, maybe it's not the ideal medium for you. But depending on their age, you'll pretty much have a better idea which one to use. Should you be using Facebook? Should you be using Twitter? If you're a business that runs a lot of events or puts on a lot of crowd-pleasing events, maybe videos or something that could be very important for your social media campaign. So maybe YouTube is something that could be important for you. But
I think you have to first work out what you want to get out of it and see which one works best for you at that stage.
John, we were talking, for those that are sitting out there and wondering, okay, I know kind of what Facebook is, but I'm not sure what Twitter is. Let's kind of break it down real quickly, what the two are.
Both of them, well, Facebook has kind of dominated the market in terms of the repository for everything. So it's your social profile, I guess. You can put your pictures, interact with people, interact with companies. If you're a business, you can create pages. So that's kind of a dominated area right now. And there's about 800 million users of Facebook, so it's where everybody is. Twitter is a little bit different. It's hard to explain, but basically it's a site where you can provide short bits of information, 140 characters, links to images or links to websites that you find interesting. I'll say that for me, I use Twitter more than anything because it's my source of information. I follow CNN, I follow MSNBC, I follow other turf organizations and people, and so it really is a way to get content, the latest information. Because if you want to get the latest information, that's where it is.
So is there, for anybody here, if I'm thinking about starting a social media, getting actively involved in an account, is one better than the other, or is it just what I do, what my business does?
Well, I think, you know, for us, it's not just one thing. I think, again, like Barry said, and you know, it's a matter of who you're trying to communicate to. You know, for part of our demographic, some of our customers, the Facebook is really good way to communicate. For some of our younger clientele, like John said, it's the Twitter is really, you know, is really fairly important. I'm not a Twitter guy yet, you know, although my son, who's our IT guy, you know, set me up now so I can actually Twitter under our Grasshopper name. But it's just a great way to immediately communicate with people. You know, if we're seeing an insect problem, and especially in the wintertime, on Facebook and on Twitter in the wintertime, you know, we do snow removal. So we get a tremendous number of people that follow us during the wintertime and rely on us more than they rely on, you know, the Weather Channel or anything else for about how things are going in Holmes County, which in turn makes us kind of the channel leader, gives a positive, you know, gives a positive relationship with our customers. So it works out good.
Mark, you guys use YouTube a lot too. You've gotten into that a little bit.
Yeah, we going back to the Twitter though, real quick. From an overall instant information standpoint, we'll use that. And we have a core group of followers that are members at Westfield that we'll update on frost delays in the fall, or if we have a rain delay, we'll tweet that out. And it's been very effective that way. And gradually, we're bringing up the followers on our Twitter account. As far as YouTube goes, I'm personally using that. I'm running for the GCSA Board of Directors, and I've used that as a tool to communicate what I'm about and what I'm going for on what my platform is, and being able to identify the support mechanisms and groups that I have at Westfield. Also, I'm looking to this winter to put on some videos as far as what we do during the winter, as far as winter maintenance, and because everybody always has a question about what do you guys on the golf course do in the winter. So we have an opportunity to show what we do and breaking down reels for grinding and so forth. So once again, another good communication.
Barry, you're well known for working with bars and restaurants and the hospitality industry. How does that translate to what we're dealing with here with the turf grass industry?
I think everybody's trying to get customers, whether you're business to business or you're business to consumer. We're all trying to grow our own business, and the principles are still the same. You want to be either a thought leader in your own particular field. Maybe you're a thought leader on property maintenance, property management, on turf. Maybe you are the best bar in the area or the best restaurant. Whatever it is, you'll have a core following of people who love what you do. And it's about taking your marketing down to a very, very local level to the people who want to hear from you, and you build a deeper relationship with them. So it doesn't matter whether it's a bar or a restaurant, whether it's a golf course or a turf management company. We all have something to offer our customers to get them closer to us and get them to eventually make a purchasing decision because they feel like they trust us more and they know more about us than just a quarter page ad in a magazine?
You know, you look at, I work for a television station and have for 30 some years, so it's hard to say something about don't advertise on my television station because it pays my salaries. But the fact of the matter is, whether it's YouTube, Facebook, or Twitter, there's one key word to all of them, and that is free. And that I guess, is the driving point, isn't it, to what kind of we're talking about here?
Yeah, from our aspect, from a club standpoint, we've gone from printing off newsletters, news magazines, and so forth to, you know, as I mentioned before, the diverse group of demographics that we have, some people still want that. So when we look at that, we'll produce on demand. Okay, if they want a copy of it, we'll print a copy of what we send out. But then I'll send an email out periodically to our members, whether it's once a week or twice a week, and then I'll have our links to our Twitter account and also any YouTube videos and so forth, so we're able to hit all cross-sections at no cost.
John, you used to tell your students to stay away from their social media. I guess your feelings have changed a little bit as a teacher?
Maybe. Yeah, I would tell them to stay away from it initially, and part of it was ignorance on my part. I wasn't on it, and it wasn't until I got on it that I kind of learned how to use it, and now I use it to educate them to hopefully improve their privacy settings and share, you know, what should be on there and what shouldn't. I think that we just have a habit of kind of dumping a lot of stuff onto those social networking sites without thinking about it. And I think in Facebook's mind, their culture is they'd like to have that be the case, that then nobody would care about it. Who cares if there's a person doing something illegal on there? Who cares if the people are underage drinking? They want it to be a culture, I think, of it's just no big deal anymore. So I still have mixed feelings about the use of Facebook and the proper use, but I think it is, I've learned how to use it as a good tool for business, for personal, so I think it is effective.
Kim, Grasshopper Property Management uses Facebook instead of a website, correct? Or is along with?
We're, you know, and one of the things about that Barry said this morning is that people with social media, they're coming to us. You know, they're liking us, or they're signing up for Twitter, or they're coming to us. And other people know that. And, you know, Barry said this morning, if somebody goes to your website, nobody knows that they went to your website. You know, with Twitter and Facebook especially, if somebody likes you or responds to something, you know, as Barry described, I should let you do this. You know, it's a ripple effect. You know, other people, you know, see that connection. And we do, we're this winter we'll finish our website and get that up and running. But, you know, the focus of our, and that'll adjust a little bit, the focus of any advertising of what we do on Facebook or any of the other social things will be this winter to drive people to our website where they can find more detailed information, find more pictures, find more information. You know, what we hope to do with Facebook is kind of pique people's interest to get them to connect with us. And then once we start a relationship with them, then we can continue to involve them in you know, whether it's print website or a visit, whatever it takes, then we can do.
Now, I think you brought along some examples, I think. Do we have some examples that we can throw up on the screen?
I've got my clicker here.
Okay.
So we'll,
there
we'll
we go.
See.
You can see it right down here, right in front of you.
So, yeah, that's during Veterans Day, you know, one of the things that we're using social media for and Facebook for is just to kind of keep people up to date. You know, if we have a new hire, you know, if something special is going on. We participated in a Day of Remembrance up at the National Cemetery near Wadsworth, and several of our guys volunteered their time, and we took equipment and so forth. And it was really a special, very, very special day. So it was a highlight, something we could get out to people that like us, and several of the guys shared it on their Facebook pages, so, you know, that ripple effect continued out. the guy in the red sweatshirt is John Candle. He is a Marine veteran. So on Veterans Day, you know, we made a special salute to John and honored him for his service to our country. So that's how we use, you know, some of the Facebook stuff. I don't see it real well. This is, just a fun, another Facebook thing. You know, we'll share information and so forth. We put in a new playground at a church, and just showing people we have fun. You know, if someone's following us and looking for some place to work maybe in the future, it's, you know, Grasshoppers might be a fun place to be. And then just, you know, just more examples of some of the feedback and so forth that we get from customers. And, I think this is Twitter. You know, we're installing flowers at one of our restaurants this spring. And, you know, just again, information, letting people know what we're up to. And, you know, people will respond, well, I didn't know you did annual color. I didn't know you did this. I didn't know you did, you know, water features or lighting or whatever. And then just the expansion of that, picking up things on Twitter that are, and featuring pictures of what we're doing there. It's, you know, cleanups. The guys, you know, and again, fun stuff. You know, the guys happened to find a toad that was hanging out with a couple of lawn ornaments that were also toads, so, you know, weren't sure if he was, you know, trying to date or what there. So, you know, just, you know, and again, just, you know, a beautiful Holmes County day, and just keeping up with things. YouTube, you know, we try to use that a lot. Sometimes the crew is not always as fun with that. We use Flickr, we use Google, and just a lot of other things, just, again, to get the information out there.
You know, you look at the way, I mean, I'm sure there are people out there who said, you know, that email thing's never going to work, Barry, and, you know, and now we've gone to Facebook and Twitter and the like. But there's also, even away from those social media pages, there is also just developing your company and being able to have your company found on the internet through Google, through all the search engines. You look at all of those different things, and there's just a multitude of ideas that is going to help your company.
I think social media has changed how we make our decisions. 10 years ago, certainly, we searched for everything. Google taught us how to find things. Social media now, products and the news finds us. And that's a complete shift. And it's something that we have to respond to. So while we have to grow our business and be found on the regular channels like Google, we also still have to be regularly found in a magazine or a newspaper because there are still people who want that. So it's not eliminating one in favor of the other. Unfortunately, we are adding quite a number of layers to all that we do, but that's because our customers have chosen to use those layers. So 5 years ago, I would have said, sure, let's get on MySpace and use it. Then it became Facebook and Twitter and so forth. So we have to keep moving to where our customers exist. If they want to do business on Facebook, we have to do business or our competitors will pass us by. But for the first time ever, we now have a chance to have a conversation back and forth. We can build up a relationship with our customers. We couldn't do that years ago. It was just broadcasting. Now we can take broadcasting to another level and engage the customer and help influence their decision a little bit more and just be known as the expert in our field. So it's a complete shift, and I don't think it's anything we can avoid.
Yeah, because you look at it from the media standpoint, and, you know, in my days as being a sportscaster, we used to talk about scoops. You know, you want to scoop somebody on a story. You don't scoop anybody on a story anymore, because by the time I go at 6 o'clock and put something on, some what I call breaking news on, it's already been on every social media outlet already, and not just because somebody found out and told somebody else, but the person probably addressed it on social media, on their Twitter or their Facebook page.
Well, Mike, along those lines, as we developed our Twitter at Westfield and communicating to the members, one side benefit that I saw was the fact that I started getting superintendents to follow me. And, hey, what's going on at Westfield? Hey, you got an inch of rain this morning or half inch of rain? And now I've seen more superintendents pick up on that, and I think it's kind of neat that I'm able to follow Jim Campion at NCR Country Club, and you know, we're, you know, 3 hours away, but yet I know what's going on at his club minute by minute, and vice versa. So from an organizational standpoint, from the superintendent's world, we're able to stay in communication with each other a lot quicker.
Speaking of Jim Campion, I know Jim real well, and one of the most amazing iPhone picture takers you will ever see. Jim has taken some pictures of his golf course, NCR Country Club, and they are just phenomenal. And I think he's probably put those out on Facebook and Twitter as well. John, concerns from anybody out there about privacy, security? I mean, there really is not a lot of privacy if you're going to go social media, is there?
No, I mean, there's privacy settings. There's a way to protect yourself to some degree, but if you're going to put it online, you have to assume that ultimately you can get out there to somebody. There's not really anything that you publish in Facebook with the strongest privacy settings in the world. Somebody can ultimately get access to that, because unless you're sharing just with yourself, which defeats the purpose of social media, then somebody can show somebody else a picture. For instance, I have privacy settings where my students can only access certain stuff on my Facebook page, certain group of photos, certain things. I don't post anything on my Facebook that I'm not comfortable with, but I still limit them. But if they're sitting with another superintendent in their office and they're looking at my Facebook page, they don't have the same privacy settings. So they could still see stuff that wouldn't normally be visible to them. So privacy, I think, is there, but it's, you have to be real careful about it. And if you put anything on that you don't want to ultimately get out, it's probably a good idea not to post it.
I think there's a difference between like privacy settings as an individual and privacy settings as a business. As an individual, you do want to restrict certain things. Perhaps you don't want your workmates seeing all of your family photos, perhaps. But as a business, you don't want to restrict people's access. You want to allow them get access whenever they want to have access. When businesses first started using Facebook, they all used a regular profile where you had to add the business as a friend. And Facebook quickly realized they needed to develop a business profile where anybody could access it without permission basis. So if at 3 o'clock in the morning I want to learn more about John's business or anybody else, I can do that in my own time. I don't have to wait for permission. So as a business, we want to share as much as we can, because that's really the goal of us being on social media.
Kim, what about, I don't know if you're the one to address this or not, but your Facebook, your Twitter, what about linking the social media? They can be linked.
Yeah, they can. I mean, we use the Twitter. You know, a lot of times, you know, especially, you know, some of our crew members are linking their Twitter accounts and they're posting it up on Facebook, you know, and vice versa. So, you know, they are linking some of those things back and forth. We're linking Facebook to Flickr, which is a photo storage area, to LinkedIn and some other things. So, you know, and again, we're just beginning to really find how we can link some of those things together. But again, it's like advertising. You know, it's not just one thing that's gonna reach all of your customers. It's a combination we see of all of those things. Social media is not gonna do everything for us, but it's one element that helps us, and there's several elements within the social media that reaches a variety of people.
Yeah, I just wanted to touch on that as well. I think the linking of things is important from the standpoint that not everybody uses the same social media. So I really like Twitter, and that's where I get a lot of my information. But I also want to be able to reach people in a bunch of different environments. So I'm a big photographer, so I'll post stuff on my Flickr account, and I might pull somebody in from a photo that I posted into my site that they had no interest in visiting my site, but I pulled them in because of a different media, or a YouTube video, or an image, or Twitter, or something. So for me, especially in extension and academia, we're trying to reach a larger audience. We have to make sure that we put the information out there, whether it be the same or different. We have to put it out there in every possible format we can so that we reach as large an audience as possible. And the example I use is I have a superintendent in Long Island, and he asked me routinely to come and speak. And I said, just email me the information and I'll come out. And he said, well, I don't have email. I said, you never have email? He said, no, I have a fax machine. And I said, well, I don't have a fax machine, right? So I know for him, if I want to get in touch with him, I have to call him. Some people like Twitter, some people like fax, some people like Facebook, but we have to get it out there in as big an environment as possible to reach a large audience.
Let's wrap this up a little bit by hitting all four of you with a question. You know, 10 years ago, nobody knew what Facebook was. Nobody knew what Twitter was. 10 years from now, 5 years from now, let's start with you, Mark. What's the future of social media for your business, for what people are doing here today?
For our business, particularly the golf course management world, I see obviously a continued use of the Twitter, not so much Facebook, but just to update current information on what's going on, weather conditions, what's going on at your course. I also look at QuickTime or FaceTime and seeing the expansion of that from us. And I've actually at Westfield tried to explore utilizing that in our operations. If I have if I have a situation on one of my holes on the golf course where I've got a disease outbreak or a drainage situation, I would be able to go out and virtually broadcast from that area and explain what's going on. And for me, although I'm no media mogul or anything like that, I think that's where it goes. I think it's on the spot. Basically, what we're doing right now with words and some pictures, I think the FaceTime is there.
Okay, for those of you that don't know FaceTime, that's Mac. That's an Apple-based system. What's the one for PC? Is there a PC version? Skype is the PC version of that. But that's the thing that's next, I guess. John, go ahead.
I think that the social media is going to be pretty competitive in the next few years. I would say Google Plus is now Facebook's answer to MySpace. And there's some functionality on there that's even better than on Facebook. I think the driving force is not so much the social media aspects and Twitter and Facebook and all that. I think the driving force is going to be the technology that people try to develop to adapt to those social media outlets. It's going to make businesses and the smartphone and iPads and everything so much more of a time saver for people, because they're going to develop technologies that people can use in their business or time management. That's going to take all the industries to a new level. Having said that, turf is always probably 10 years behind anything else. So if you if you think of where turf is now, whatever the other groups are, then that's where we'll be in 10 years.
Yeah, it's well put. Yeah, well put, John. That sums it up well. I think things will continue to get fragmented. Because there's Google Plus, there's LinkedIn, there's all these other things that are coming down the pike. So I think things will continue to get fragmented. I think it will become more and more and more important. And one of the stats that was on the thing is how many people my age, I'm the old guy up here, 55 and older, are getting into Facebook. And it is absolutely amazing. How many friends that I'm finding on that are asking me to friend them on Facebook that are in their 70s and 80s. I mean, it is absolutely astounding, and they love it because it's a great way for them to communicate, and it's a surprisingly good way to communicate with our customers. But the technology and how we do it, I think, will be one of the big things. We're doing a big tree installation at a restaurant up in our area, and my son is finishing up his landscape architecture study down here at OSU, and doing an internship for a firm here, and he had placed all the trees for us on the design off of a satellite map, satellite photo of this restaurant where we're planting them. And then just put the GPS coordinates of where each tree and each type of tree should be. And then we just go out with our smartphone and locate that GPS coordinates, and that's where we plant the tree. Wow. And that's all I can say. And that, what's next? And it's not what's going to happen in 5 years or 10 years. What's going to happen next year or next month, I think is a part of it too.
I think in the hospitality space and for brick and mortar businesses, there are two developments I think are going to have to come and will come. One is going back to giving value in an increasingly crowded space in social media. Businesses have to develop content and information that is of value to their customers, and that's not just about broadcasting happy hour specials, information like that. It's about using this fantastic suite of technology that we have available to give old school value back using new school technology. So that's going to have to be adopted more. And the second thing I see coming is location-based services. So as you're near a bar, a restaurant, a business, that you're getting maybe communications based on things that you've opted in for. So if you're a fan of a certain golf course or a country club, maybe as you're driving past, you might get a little notification saying, we got a special on our dinner tonight, drop on in, or something like that. So location base is going to be big as smartphones are developed further.
Yeah, because the thing about it is you can be on Facebook and you can be on Twitter as a business, but if you don't work it properly, it's kind of a waste of time.
Yeah, it's about turning a browser into a customer. So take the person offline and into your business has to be the ultimate goal always.